AS, we looked at the structure of the heart and the control of the heart as it passed through the whole phase of the cardiac cycle. And today what we're looking at is what controls the heart. But before we do that, I just want to recap on all the things to do with the electrical excitation of the heart, especially now that we know about the action potential and what causes it. So if we imagine we're looking at the outside of the heart, and we know that the heart is divided into four chambers, and what we have here is a patch of cells called the sinoatrial node. Now, you'll have heard of them as a pacemaker, and this is when people have a pacemaker put into their heart. This is a patch of tissue that occurs naturally, but that sometimes gets replaced by an artificial one. Now, this patch of tissue is actually just a group of cells that are unstable. So normally, when we've talked about the action potential, and we've talked about the sodium, potassium, pump, and we've talked about the sodium channels and that there's a stimulus that's needed to change those sodium channels so that the cell becomes depolarized and we start an action potential. Well, with this patch of cells in the heart, you do not need a stimulus. It's myogenic. In other words, we don't need an external stimulus for these cells to undergo an action potential. What happens is it just happens all the time. So they just sort themselves out in terms of their ions, and then the next minute the sodium channels open, the sodium rushes in, and the potential of the cell is reversed and an action potential is started. So what happens then is a wave of excitation is passed along the neurons over the atria of the heart, and that in turn, because the nerves are connected to the cardiac muscle, causes a contraction. So what we end up with is a wave of excitation followed by a wave of contraction that starts here and passes over the atria. Now, clearly in chapter 7, you remember, we learned about how, what is it that causes these valves to open into the ventricles. And it was when the pressure in the atria exceeds the pressure in the ventricles, and that forces them through. And that is true here. So the wave of excitation causes the wave of muscular contraction and the blood empties in. Now, the key thing is the uplift in this lesson that we're looking at is across here, separating the atria and the ventricles. We've got like a band, it's like a belt of thick, more fibrous tissue. It's almost like scar tissue. And if you can imagine like scar tissue, it's not gonna contract, it's not gonna transmit the electrical conductivity, the electrical impulse that's emanating from the sinoatrial node. So in essence, what happens is the contraction moves to there and then it stops. And what we want is we now want the ventricles to empty. What we do have is a little node here. And it's called, because it's between the atria and the ventricles, it's called the atrioventricular node. Now that can pass the electrical conductivity through into the ventricles. And if we think about it, when we squeeze the blood from the atria into the ventricles, the actual direction of flow then of the blood out of the heart is from the bottom up. And we need the excitation to start from there now to push the blood out of the heart, because of course, if we think about its gross structure, its three-dimensional structure, the blood vessels are actually coming out of the ventricle from here. So what the AV node does is it gathers like a load of neurons together, and it bunches them and it insulates them in a bundle, a little bit like a wire that's full of lots of wires but is insulated by a rubber insulation. And they pass all the way down to the bottom. And that bundle is called the bundle of His. When it gets to the bottom, they're then free to permeate into the cardiac muscle. And at that point, they're uninsulated. So now the electrical impulse, the action potential, travels down the length of the neuron, and then as it passes up through the cardiac muscle, its action potential stimulates muscular contraction, and then what we get is the contraction of muscle from the base up. So there's a couple of advantages here. There's a slight time delay. These contract, the impulse travels down the bundle of His to here. These things are called Purkinje fibers. You need to know all these words. Purkinje fibers. So the advantage is that because these empty and then there's a slight time delay, we're talking like 0.2 of a second, but that slight time delay is exactly right for us because as the impulse travels to the bottom, it ensures that the atria have had time to fully empty and the ventricles have had time to fully fill before we start the contraction back out. And so both atria contract at the same time and both ventricles contract afterwards. So we get like a lub-dub sound. Those, then those, then those. And as those are contracting, these are then relaxing and filling, as you'll remember from chapter 7. So the main thing is this word myogenic, and what does it mean? It means that this patch of tissue doesn't need an external stimulus for it to start an action potential. And so in essence, you know when you see those horror films where the vampire or whatever comes along and it grabs the heart out of someone's chest and it's still beating in their hands? That is actually, it could happen. If you take a heart out and you surround it in the correct ion balance with the correct concentration of sodium and potassium ions around it, it will continue to beat. And the other words that you need to know are definitely about the sinoatrial node, atrioventricular node, bundle of His, and Purkinje fibers.